Okay. Good evening, everyone. I'm glad to be back here. I think it was 2 or 3 months since I was here last time. I ask what to talk about, and always is the same answer, and it's always a correct answer. What does a person need the most in his life? That we have to constantly speak about it nonstop. What does a person need the most in his life that we constantly need it every second of our life? And without it, very difficult to be religious. The answer, of course, as you probably know, faith, emunah. The problem with faith, unlike other things, everything in life that you learn about, once you know it for the rest of your life. That's it. You learn, you know it. You learn math, you know math. That's it. You learn to be a doctor, you're a doctor for the rest of your life. You need to drive, you learn to drive, you're a driver for the rest of your life. Emunah, faith, you learn all week, nonstop. You read books. You learn Gemarot about it. It makes you feel very strong. 1 or 2 weeks, you dropped it, you'll go back to zero. Very interesting. Technically, why it doesn't stay? Why, when we learn, when you read now a very good book about Emunah, about faith, strong book, and makes you feel so great, now you don't want to fight with your competitors in business today. You don't want to argue with your wife about spending money. You don't want to check the credit card bills. You feel great. It's all from Hashem anyway. What am I killing myself? You close the store an hour earlier. You go to the synagogue. You learn. What are you doing? Don't worry. Parnasa, it's from Hashem. You don't open so early. You feel great. You have a relief. 2, 3 days later, you're back to zero. Again, a wolf, against fighting, against Lashon Hara, against I'll kill him, I'll show him, I'll show her. Did you ever ask yourself, how can it be? Why is it not like everything else? You learn, learn, learn. You know, Hashem runs the world. He gives the money, nothing else. It's all from him. That's it. Why do I have to kill myself for the rest of my life? I'm with it. I know it. The answer, because the test of the life is the test of Emunah. Just when we read in Adam HaRishon, we just read Bereshit, Bereshit bara Elokim, and the 6th day Hashem made Adam and Chava, the man and his wife, first couple in the history of the world. Now when Hashem make a match, וירא השם כי לא טוב היות האדם לבדו, it's not good for the man to be alone, I אעשה לו עזר כנגדו, I'm going to make him a partner, a match, a soulmate, call it any way you want, it's all true. When Hashem make a match, right, does he match the best possible way, or it's like the matchmaking of today? Just give the check and get out of here. When Hashem make a match, no? You know 100%. I want to ask you, I forget 1 second. When you go and buy a furniture, you have to assemble it. So you have a bag with the screws. So when you have the screw and there's a holes, do you ever have a doubt if the screw would fit the holes? You always know it's going to work, right? You're not worried. Wow, I hope it's going to fit. Imagine if the screws are not good. Well, you count on a manufacturer to be a little bit smart to know to give the right screw that match the right place. Right or wrong? So you have to give Hashem a little bit more credit that if he match a woman to a man, it's a perfect match. Right? And what happened right after that? They had a fight. What happened? She came. The snake came to her and said to her, don't worry, if you eat from the tree, nothing will happen. You're not going to die. Mm-hmm. Here I ate and I'm still alive. See, life is great. Hashem is afraid that you're going to be like him. You're going to be like a god. You know now things. That's why he wants to keep you away from this great treasure. The snake knew how he was a very good salesman. You know, it's like reverse psychology. You know, like when a customer comes to the store, no, that's not in your league. That's not in your league. That's not for you. What do you mean not for me? I want it. If you tell them, yeah, try, come, it's for you. No, no, I'll think about it. Once you tell him, no, no, it's not for you, it's not in your league, his ego right away makes, he will pay 20 years the loan now. But he tried to make a point. So the snake, he tricked Chava very well. He told her, ah, nothing will happen to you, just afraid, Hashem is afraid. So you're going to be somebody special. Right away she ate from it. After she ate from it, she realized, wait a minute. This guy fooled me. Ah, if Hashem said we're going to die, we're going to die. So now she got very scared. So what happened? She went to give Adam also to eat. If you won't be with me, you won't be with any other woman. I'll take you to grave with me. You understand? This is the concept here. So she went and convinced Adam to eat also. Look, I ate. And he ate also. And when Hashem came to Adam HaRishon, what happened? Right away, he started to complain about her. It's all her fault. But Hashem made a great match. If the people don't work on their ego, their anger, their lack of emuna, no matter what kind of a shidduch Hashem will give you, it will never work. 90% at least, of the couple who got divorced, they were actually the right match. They blew it. Why they blew it? Because they are losers. They didn't want to work on themselves. They didn't want to work on their laziness. They didn't want to fight with their anger. They did not want to fight with their desires, with all kinds of infatuations that they had in their mind, with greed, with ego, with jealousy, with politics, with a wish to control. And because of all these negative things, they messed up their life. And some of them stayed single for the rest of their life. 30, 40 years they have suffered. They stay with the same agony that they have before, that they had before they got divorced. Same problems with the kids and the money and the fights. Everything the same. That part stayed. The good part of the relationship, when we were together, they had some nice moments, they also lost. So they lost it from both directions. I'm not talking when really the man was a monster and he was abusing her and violent. That's a different story. Then you have to get rid of someone like that before you be dead. But I'm talking regular, you know, fighting, disrespect, things like this. No attention to each other. The usual stuff. 90% of the marriages, from experience, I'm telling you. It's because we take something that Hashem gave us and we mess it up. That's it. Much like that, 100%. It's not only about marriages. It could be in a yeshiva. You have a nice chevruta, you learn with him, he gives his heart for you to teach you. You don't appreciate it, you always want something better. You look around, oh, somebody has suggested to learn with you. Right away, you drop the other one. No appreciation, no gratefulness, 100% selfishness. You went with a new one, he dumped you a week later, you stayed bold for the rest of your life, meaning you have nothing now. Bold on both sides. When you're bold on one side, the other side can cover. When you're bold on both sides, nothing will help you this time. Do you understand the concept? Why do we speak about this? Because I asked what to talk about, and the answer was few things, Rabbi. One, faith, emunah, which we will. Second, not to speak in a shul. Not to speak in a shul. Every time I go to speak in a shul, in a synagogue, and I ask the person who invited me, or one of them, what should I speak? Usually it's the answer, not to speak in a shul. You know? So you speak about it for so many years, it's like talking to the wall. The wall don't talk. In a synagogue, the walls are quiet. The walls get the message. Why Moshe Rabbeinu hit the rock, do you know? Hashem said to Moshe, speak to the rock. Why he took his stick and he hit the rock? He could have spoken to the rock. He didn't need to hit the rock. What's the difference, speaking to the rock or hitting the rock? One way or the other, it's a miracle. even if Moshe speaks to the rock and water comes out, it's 100% miracle against the law of nature. And if you take a little stick and you hit the rock and water comes out, it's exactly the same miracle. How hitting made it different than speaking to the rock? If Hashem wants to make a 100% miracle, he would do it one way or the other. Or he would do it in any other rock. It doesn't have to be this rock. Anyway, it's a miracle. Does it make a difference for Hashem? It's like going like that, and everything gets done. With the rock, without the rock. Moshe Rabbeinu knew, if I will speak to the rock and the rock will give water, the Jewish nation will suffer forever after that. Why? Because the Satan, every time he make a case against a Jew, the Satan will use this example. Hashem, you spoken to the rock, and the rock listen. And these children of you, that you gave them so much, whatever you tell them to do, they never want to do. That'll be the end of us. It's like a good lawyer case. He makes a case. The rock listens, but the people don't. So Moshe say, when I hit the rock doesn't have a choice. You hit the rock, you gotta give water. Of course, that's an analogy, but for us to get the point. It's very interesting because speaking in a shul connects to this parasha, Parashat Bereshit, that we just read 2 days ago. What's the connection between the creation of the world and Adam and Chava and Cain and Evel to speaking in a synagogue? What's the connection? Technically none. What's the connection? You can speak about relationship, marriage, soulmate. There's a connection. You should not kill. There's a connection. Shatnez. Don't wear woolen linen. There's a connection. Hashem said to Cain and Evel, bring me a sacrifice. Cain brought the linen. Evel brought the sheep. Evel was a shepherd. Cain was a farmer. He brought the linen. Evel brought the wool from the sheep. Hashem accepted the gift of Evel, and because of jealousy, Cain murdered him. So Hashem said, because of wool and linen, the first murder in a creation happened, they can never get together. That's it. That's a decree. So there is a connection. Parashat Bereshit, it connects. Redemption of the firstborn. It connects to the parasha. Bereshit, the word Bereshit, Ben Rishon Acharei Shloshim Yom Tifdeh, Bereshit. That's what it means. Bereshit, Bet, Ben, Resh, Rishon, right? Acharei, Aleph, Shloshim, Yom, Yud, Tifdeh, Taf, Bereshit. They asked the Gaon Mivilna this question. They said that in the word Bereshit, all the 613 commandments are in it. What's the connection between Bereshit and redemption of the firstborn? So the Gaon Mivilna in a second answer. Bereshit, abbreviation. Ben Rishon Acharei Shloshim Yom Tifdeh. Meaning the redemption of the newborn. So again, you can find a lot of mitzvot that connects to Bereshit. Brit Milah, Adam and Eve, they have children. No. Purvu. It's the first mitzvah in the Torah. Purvu. Multiply. No. Well, what's the connection between not speaking in a synagogue? The answer, Rabotai, when Cain murdered Hevel, Hashem came to him. Cain didn't know, a few things he didn't know. One, he didn't know what does it mean to kill. Take somebody and you hit him in the head. You never saw anyone die. You just came to the world. No one ever died in front of you. You never watched movies. You never saw anyone dead. You didn't know about the concept of being dead. You know there is a time that you up, times that you go to sleep. But you didn't know there is such a thing to go to sleep forever and never get up. They didn't know. So now he found out that after he made his brother go to sleep, he's not waking up. 1 day, 2 days, 5 days, something happened. Until now he was waking up every day. Now he will never wake up. He got the point. So Hashem came to him. Hashem didn't say to him, why did you kill your brother? He asked him, where is your brother? Because there's a very important rule the way Hashem runs the world. Hashem is always eager for the person to confess. It's one thing you did something against what I say. you did something wrong. But when I approach you, or the rabbi, which is my representative for the argument's sake now, when they approach you and you are doing something wrong, I always expect from you immediately, not a second later, immediately to say, oh my God, you're right, I'm so sorry. Chatati, aviti, pashati. What should I do to fix? Immediately, most of the crime and the sin that you made is almost forgiven. Almost everything. We have it written clearly. Modeh ve'ozev yerucham. Soon as you admit and you leave the sin, immediately you get mercy from Hashem. Yerucham, that's it. So it's very interesting. You didn't pay back yet. You didn't pay the suffering that you're supposed to. Really, technically, nothing changed. You just admit it, and you left the sin. I won't do it again. Two things. It's true, I did it, and I am not going to do it again. Immediately, you're already moving from the negative to the positive side. What about the penalty? What about jail? What about all kinds of things that you're supposed to do? Soon as you admit right away. But if it takes you a minute, it takes you a minute to admit, it's already not so good. It's already a problem. In the end, everyone will admit. You cannot run away from the truth. But the fact that it took you more than a second to admit, it's already a problem. Meaning, remember in life, it's very common with children. With the children, there are different kind of children. When you come and say, who took the cake from the closet without permission? They're not always admitting. You come to the first one, Avram. You did it? Not me. Yeah, Yitzchak. You did it? Not me. Yaakov, you did it? Not me. But one of them did. Not Eliyahu Hanavi, didn't need it. You begin to put pressure. Sometimes one of them will break and say it was me, sometimes not. Sometimes one will say he did it about someone else. Why? To save himself. It's true, he did it. Avram said, but Yaakov, he did it. Why? Not because he wanted to hurt him. Because he first wanted to clear himself from the suspicion. Sometimes he will tell you he did it, even though he knows you don't suspect him. I know it's not you. Relax. And then he comes and he says to you, he did it. Why? He wants him to suffer. That's already a worse level of personality. Why kids lie, do you know? Why people lie in general? Person lied to the police, the kid lied to his father. It's also the police. For him. Why people lie?
To avoid punishment.
Huh?
To avoid punishment.
To avoid punishment. They live in such a reality that they think that by lying, I will avoid the suffering that is due to me. When is the first time that it happened in a creation? First time in a creation, the person lied to avoid suffering or embarrassment. Huh? First time. Adam HaRishon didn't lie. Hashem asked him, did you eat from the tree? He didn't say no. He just blamed Chava. He blamed Chava. The snake lied not to avoid suffering from himself, to get somebody else into trouble. Like the third example that I gave. First time a person lied to avoid shame and problem is Cain. When Hashem came to Cain, he didn't ask him why you killed your brother. He asked him, where is your brother? He knew where his brother is. So he asked him, he said to Hashem, Hashomer achi anochi, what do you want from me? I'm his bodyguard. I'm his keeper. He didn't know the ability of Hashem. Remember, it's all new to him. Today we know Hashem sees everything. If we would kill a person and Hashem would come to us and ask her, where is John? What would we say? Right away, we'll know that there's no way to run. No, it's Hashem. It's not the policeman asking question. If Hashem would come to us and say, where is John? I buried him over here. Why are you so honest? Because you know one way or the other you're going to get caught. So I might as well pretend I'm honest, no? Maybe I get something out of it. Maybe I get a discount, right? If the policeman tells you, we're going to check the camera in 5 minutes and see who's the one who robbed the house. And there's 10 people. And you know that in 5 minutes they're going to see you. So if you're stupid, you wait 5 minutes. Waiting for a miracle. Maybe Eliyahu HaNavi would come. Maybe a typhoon would come, a tornado. Maybe something, maybe the camera won't work. But if you're smart, you run to the policeman right away to confess. Why? At least you're honest. Here, you see, I confessed. Did you hear that they stole 4 Sifre Torah this week from Brooklyn? From Avenue O? So everyone is impressed why the thief brought back the 4 Sifre Torah. I say for that he deserves double punishment for bringing them back. When you deserve a reward when you make repentance, tshuva, and you return what you stole, when? When no one in the world knows about you, no one can turn you in, and now you feel guilty. What did I do? I went against Hashem, I stole. Now you come and you bring it back. For someone like that, we gotta take the head off. Wow, kol hakavod. You did tshuva, no punishment at all. That's what the Torah say. But if somebody comes and say, I saw what you did, I'm giving you 24 hours to turn yourself in. If not, I will turn you in. And then you'll come to the police, listen, I want to be tzaddik, I'm doing tshuva. You deserve reward. No, you're only going to know that if this guy will turn you on, your situation will be a lot worse. You might as well cut half of your jail time by confessing. It's a blackmail. Someone will turn you in. That's it. This guy, after he stole the 4 Sifret, first of all, who does steal Sifret Torah? Even thieves, they have a heart, right? You know how many times thieves stole something and then they published on the news, it was sentimental, it was belonged to my father that died in the Holocaust, and they returned it? They could have sold it. Holocaust, not Holocaust, what do I care? I'm going to make $1,000 from this object. Well, when they say in Israel, you know, we don't care about the money he stole, but he stole this that was belonged to my father, and it's the only thing we have from him after he died in Auschwitz. So the thief, he cannot live with himself. He doesn't care the fact that he's a thief and he steals every day. That's he got used to already. But the fact that he stole something sentimental, that it's the only connection to these people, to their parents that died in Auschwitz, he feels like a real monster. Slowly, slowly, he comes and he puts it back. Why is it? Because even thieves have a conscience to some extent. Why would a person steal a Sefer Torah? There's so many other things to steal in the world. To come steal the Sefer Torah? Is anything worse than that to steal? The answer, there's only one answer. One answer. Who knows what? Heroin addict. That's the only answer. A drug addict. Drug addict will sell his mother if he can for $20 for the drugs. That's what people don't understand.
Maybe he want to be a feminist.
He would sell everyone. He'll sell Sefer Torah, he will sell his tefillin. If his father bought him tefillin for $1,000 and he need drugs now for the next 4 hours, he'll sell it for $20. $1,000 tefillin. Just to keep going the next 4 hours. This is it. So if a person doesn't have money and he knows there's a way to go into a shul, somehow he'd figure out a way, what can you steal from the shul? What are you going to steal? The pictures? The clock? Something valuable. Sefer Torah worth a lot of money. So why did this guy returned it? He couldn't sell it anymore. It was all over WhatsApp, all over Facebook, all over pictures, emails, police already published it. Everyone he will come to sell it, no one would buy it from him. Because right away they know I'm getting myself into this trouble. I just met somebody now. He told me that one person that he knows went to jail for 4 years. But then they gave him a discount, 2 years and something, for buying stolen jewelry. He bought jewelry from a thief, I guess for very cheap. He got caught for buying the stolen jewelry. Almost, he got 4 years in prison. After all, spending millions for lawyers, they reduced it to 2-point-something years. From buying it. Not for stealing it. I don't know how much the thief got. How did they know who bought the jewelry? Huh? As soon as they catch the thief, They're telling me, you want to sit 10 years in prison? Or you want to make a deal that you're only going to sit 4 years? Of course, 4 years. So you will become our informer. You will tell us all the people you sold it to. Right away, in a second, even if his uncle, he gives the whole list. And right away, they begin to record and they follow people and they check their bank account. And that's how they bring 50 people in one shot. What do you think, they sweat? They just catch the people and the people begin to sing. That's how it goes. That's why all these foolish people, when they come and offer them stolen merchandise, it's just a matter of time until you go to jail. You say first time, second time, for not to talk about the fact that no matter what money you make from it, you will never see a drop of blessing from it. It will go for sicknesses, for problem with the marriage, problem with the children, problem with the house. Guarantee, leak over here, hurricane over there, flood in a basement, engine in a car went down, $10,000 for it. Whatever comes illegally against Hashem, I'm talking about, will go in a not normal way. Not in the normal food, it's normal, we have to eat. Clothing, it's normal. Tuition for yeshivot, it's normal. This is a way of life. That's not a not normal way to lose money. But when the engine goes on fire, or there's a flood, and from all the neighborhood, your basement is the only one who flooded, and $60,000 damage, that's the end of Hashem, you can see right away. Directed the water to you. You could push it that way. Maybe the wind would go the other way around. Up the hill, down the hill, the door had a hole. There's a lot of reasons why Hashem does what he does. But it's all directed 100%. So we started to explain, Hashem came to Cain, and he asked him, where is your brother Evel? And he said, I'm not his keeper. And Hashem told him, the bloods of your brother is screaming to me from the ground. Not only him, his children, grandchildren, until the end of time, meaning billions of people. If from Cain, right, Cain left, Evel died. Today, how many people you have in the world? 7.5 billion. Imagine if it would be Cain and Evel. It would be double. Right? If the pyramid start with one person, it went to 7.5. It would be 2 people. It would be double. More or less, of course. By the way, when I say it's not 100% correct, why? Because the people in the world didn't come from Cain. All his children died. It came from the third son that Adam HaRishon had, from Sheth. From Sheth. All the world came from Sheth. But still, it's no contradiction. If Cain wouldn't kill Evel, and there would be Cain, Evel, and then later Sheth, you would have 30 billion people in the world. Because Cain and Evel got lost. So from 3 people, only 1 left. So there should have been 20-something million people today. Right? It grows in the same pace. So Hashem came to him and he said, all the people that should have come to the world and they will not come now to the world, they're all screaming to me from the ground. Meaning by Hashem there is no past, present and future. For Hashem it's present right now. So when he told it to him, he actually spoke about people today. Souls that today wants to come to the world and they didn't come to the world because he killed their grandfather, they still scream to Hashem. And even on those Hashem spoke. From here, by the way, Chazal are learning, if a person did something negative and Hashem is judging him for all the consequences, just like it says in the prophet, Meshalem la'adam ki pri ma'al alav, I'm paying a person based on the fruits of his actions, not based on his actions, based on the fruit of his actions. Fruit, meaning what would come out of that tree. You planted 1 tree, what would come out of it? You planted a different tree, what would come out of it? Good or bad? Whatever will come out of your actions, for that I'm judging you. Not only for what you did, for what would continue to happen. You open the casino, Jews are coming and gambling on Shabbat, you're attracting them to come, money, cigarettes, nervous, this, sitting all Shabbat playing cards, or throwing dice, and driving with a car, and you know, the whole system over there, and people work there, and a lot of Jews, mechalelim. So everything that happens over there goes to your account. Not only the fact that you yourself break Shabbat. The fact that you open the place that hundreds of people do it every day, you're responsible for all these people until the end of time. Even if the casino is broken already, it collapsed, finished, it was sold, it was neglected, that's it, no more. The police closed it down. Doesn't matter. The damages that you already made to people over there that affected their children because their parents lost all their money, that's how gambling ends. You lose all your money. And the kids could not go to yeshivot. Why? Because their father lost all the money in gambling. So now they went to public school, and one or two of them became murderers, and the other one was a rapist, and the other one is a pedophile, and the other one is a thief, and the other one is a prostitute. Why all of that? Because the family broke, and they grew up on the streets. And then, they know how they ended up. And the reason they are like that is because Reuven opened casino. How long ago? 50 years ago. That's why these criminals are today in jail. What's the connection? He doesn't know these people. That's how it goes. It doesn't matter you know, you don't know. So Chazal are learning, if it in a negative way it's like that, imagine in a positive way, which is always better than negative. Right? If Hashem is continuing to judge us forever and ever for the consequences of our action, when we do something good, only good would continue to come to your account nonstop. For all the good you did, you open yeshiva, you open shul, you make people religious, everything they do comes to your account forever and ever. It's a very good investment. So after Cain realized you cannot run away from Hashem, Cain said to Hashem a shocking sentence. We have to pay attention to every word in the Torah. Every word, it teaches a lot about life. Cain answered to Hashem, Gadol avoni minso. My sin is so heavy, so big, that it's impossible to bear it. It's like you cannot hold it. That's how heavy is this. Meaning I did the worst thing, Hashem. All of a sudden now he confessed. When he realized he cannot run away from Hashem, he broke. And he say, Gadol avoni minso. My sin is greater than what you can bear. Why, what's the connection between this and not speaking in a shul? In a Jewish book of law called Shulchan Aruch, when it comes to the chapter that speaks about behaving in a synagogue, Rabbi Yosef Karo, that lived 500 years ago, and he wrote the Shulchan Aruch, he wrote one time in Shulchan Aruch this sentence. Someone that committed this sin, Gadol avono minso, his sin is too heavy to bear. Only one time in a Shulchan Aruch it's written. About who? A person that speaks in a synagogue. He did not say it about the murderers. He did not say it about the rapist. He did not say it about the Mechalelei Shabbat. There are sins in a Shulchan Aruch that it's death penalty. Someone Mechalel Shabbat, death penalty. Death penalty. Idol worshiper, death penalty. There's a lot of death penalties. None of the death penalties in Shulchan Aruch, it's written next to it that the sin is too heavy to bear. On one sin, it's written in a Shulchan Aruch that someone that does it, Gadol avono minso vegoarim bo. And you have to shame him, to embarrass him. Very, very interesting. There's a very serious restriction in the Torah not to embarrass a person in public. Not to embarrass a person in public. You cannot embarrass a person in public. And if you did, what's the punishment? You heard what she said? 100%. Two things we're saying, let's say about it. One, אין לו חלק לעולם הבא. And another thing was told is, המלבין פני חברו ברבים כאילו שופך דמים. Account like he murdered him. How many people would rather die than get the embarrassment in public? How many people? Many people. If they want to publish something in newspaper, they commit suicide. They cannot live to see the embarrassment that will come out on television or on the newspaper. So what happened? They said, I'd rather die than see what's going to happen. Like this, I don't have to deal with the embarrassment. We've seen it all the time in history. However, it's very interesting. When it comes to someone that speaks in a synagogue, there is an instruction. You warn him once, twice, you take him aside quietly, you disturb the place, the holiness of the place. You cannot speak here. If the person continues, you have to embarrass him in public. What about you losing your shirt to the world to come? You have nothing to worry about. Some of the restrictions in the Torah are very severe, but with some exception to the rule. For instance, a Jew cannot give a loan to another Jew and collect interest from him. Reuven gives a loan to Shimon and collect interest from him monthly or weekly. That's a sin that for that he won't resurrect in a resurrection of the dead. When the Mashiach comes, there will be the resurrection of the dead. This Jew that collects interest, and by the way, the one who pays interest also, and the broker that introduced them to each other, and the witnesses that sign on a contract as witnesses that he gave him money, all the people that participated in a deal, they all lose their share to the world to come. Horrible, horrible thing. Unless if the person that borrowed the money is not Shomer Shabbat. If it's not a Shomer Shabbat, it's count 100% like a goy, like a non-Jew. And the Torah says clearly, Velagoy tashich. You're allowed to give a loan to a non-Jew and collect interest. You're also allowed to pay interest to a non-Jew. It works both ways. It's not your brother. So you can pay him interest, you can collect from him interest, no problem. But between two Jews, it's not permitted. Unless if the Jew that borrowed the money is Mechalel Shabbat, since he's count like a goy anyway, doesn't have a share to the world to come. Even in a Jewish cemetery, you're not allowed to bury him. Therefore, you got saved. You're not going to get punished. Same thing over here. You embarrass a person that speaks in a synagogue, Shomer Shabbat, a real Jew, but he speaks in a synagogue. And you gave him a warning quietly a few times, and he continue. And you asked him to leave, and he doesn't want, you're allowed to throw him out. Bring the security and throw him from the window. Where does it say it? In a Jewish book of law, which Baruch Hashem, I did not write. I have problems as it is without writing it, just by reading it. Imagine if I wrote it. Oh, wow. What would be? Just by reading some simple laws, you get into trouble because no one can accept the truth today. Very difficult. People want to stay in a lie. That's it. Bothers them very much. Once the Torah and the Shulchan Aruch say to do specific thing, what would happen after that, it's not our problem anymore. You understand? For instance, Sarah told Avraham Avinu, throw your son, your barbaric Arab son, away from the house. Throw him away. Avraham got very angry at Sarah. You're telling me to throw my boy from the first marriage out of the house? Imagine today, a couple get married. They both divorced. They got now remarried to each other. And the wife come to the man and say, throw your son out of the house. Throw him to the street. Most likely, he can end the marriage. If she doesn't care that the boy will be on the street, how can I be with a woman like this? No? A person will take it very much to his heart. It definitely would cause big fights. It will cause big fights. Sarah comes to Abraham. Sarah was a righteous woman. She said to him, throw this barbaric boy away. Avraham got very upset. Hashem saw that he got upset. He interfered. He came to Avraham and said, everything Sarah told you, listen to her. She's right. What would happen if you throw Ishmael away from the street? Right now, he's close to his father, Avraham. Avraham is a big tzaddik. He's giving seminars. He makes Baalei Tshuva. He converts people. What's better, that the criminal boy will be alone on the street with the gangs, or he'll be supervised by the rabbi? What's better? But Hashem says, throw him away. Why? Before he's going to spoil Yitzchak. Right now, one is good. It's a matter of time. I can see what happened. She's right. She's a prophet. By the way, Sarah did not say it on her own. She is a prophet. She was a prophet. And she told him by a prophecy. Same thing Rivka so told Yaakov to go to Yitzchak. It was by a prophecy. They didn't do things on their own, these people. That's why they mentioned in the Torah, and we are not in the Torah. They were prophets. We're not prophets. So that's one thing about the synagogue. Many people come every Shabbat to the synagogue, and sometimes in the summer, they suffer. They walk a lot because they keep Shabbat. So they walk 20 blocks. They walk 40 minutes. I'm not going to drive. Look how much they sacrifice to come to the synagogue. 40 minutes to arrive, 40 minutes to get back home, three times. Friday night, Shabbat morning, and Shabbat afternoon. How long they walk? An hour and 20, an hour and 20, and an hour and 20. 4 hours walking. Marathon. Marathon every Shabbat. It was much better for them to pray at home. They will get reward at least. Now they only get punished. Because they came all the way to the synagogue to disturb the community. They're not getting reward. They're getting 100% punishment. If they bring their little children, they get punished. And I'm not jealous with the future of these children. That they disturb the public on Shabbat or on Yom Kippur. Little kids, younger than 5 years old, do not belong in a synagogue. You want to educate them? Have patience. Everything in life has the right time for it. Some people want to teach Gemara to their newborn baby. Listen, you fool. Why don't you understand this Rashi? He doesn't understand because he's 2 months old. A little kid, the Ben Ish Chai say, up to 6 years old, they equal to monkeys. No offense. If you have little kids, their mental state is like a monkey. Monkey can jump, monkey can hang, monkey can break. Nobody blames the monkey, right? If the monkey jump on a chandelier, look at this beautiful chandelier. Yeah, the monkey over there, what do you think he would do? You throw a banana on top. Next thing, the monkey is in a chandelier. The chandelier falls, $10,000 damage. You sue him? You don't sue him. Why? He's a monkey. If a 5 years old did it, you sue him? Can you sue his father?
Yes.
Huh? What do you think? Is father responsible or no? Not true. If he did it with the tools that the father neglected, the father left a hammer here on a table, or he left a gun and he took it and shot, things like that, then the father is a part of the problem. Like the Gemara say, he gave a torch to Shote, Cheresh, Vekatan. Shote means retarded. Cheresh means deaf, but not the deaf people like today. Deaf people today, they can be big lawyers. Today they invented all kinds of tricks that they circumvent the problem. Deaf people are perfectly normal today. They have all this, the sign language, they communicate, they read. They do a lot of things. It wasn't like back in the time, someone that was deaf did not go to school. There was no technique, nobody knew the deaf language. So they were mamash isolated in a silence. Therefore, they couldn't keep mitzvot, they couldn't learn in yeshiva. The Torah dismissed them. But today it's not the case. Today they make implants inside the ear. They invent all kinds of things that to some of the deaf people it helps them. Why it's a problem of deaf? Because deaf cannot hear how to talk. If you cannot hear, you can never learn how to talk. You only see people moving their lips, so you don't hear anything. So you don't know how to cut their words. The only way you learn how to do it is by imitating people. Therefore, if you cannot talk and you cannot hear, how are you going to keep mitzvot? How are you going to learn? How are you going to pray? How are you going to learn halachot? How you ask questions? You're dismissed from keeping mitzvot. Shoteh chiresh vekatan, little kid, you gave him a torch and he burned the whole barn. Right? Whose fault is this? The person that gave him the torch. It was obvious that he's going to go and burn. What does he know about fire? But if he did it on his own, he was in a neighborhood, the father is in yeshiva, and he took a rock and he threw it on someone's windshield. And he comes to his father, pay me for $1,000 damage. He doesn't have to pay. It's not the law. What age, technically, you are dismissed from feeding your children, according to the Torah? Six. Once he's 6 years old, he can be on his own. How can it be? You put him today 2 hours on his own, he'll be dead, right? Or kill someone. 6 years old, 2,000 years ago, was around 11, 12 today, or more even. 13 already were married. People 13 were already 100% people. Today, people 26 are not mentally stable like Bar Mitzvah boy 2,000 years ago. You can see by learning Torah what was the level of the people. What age Shlomo HaMelech was the king of Israel and the king of the world? Do you know? 12. 12 years old. Today, 12 years old, if you know 5 Mishnayot, they make a party, his parents. All he knows is to play Game Boys on the iPad. What does 12 years old know? To kick the ball a little bit, to throw some balls to the basket, to annoy his parents and the neighbors, and he knows a little bit Torah. That's it. 12 years old today. What do they know? Shlomo HaMelech. Now I know what you're thinking. Oh, Hashem gave him a blessing. He made him the smartest person ever lived. Wrong. That was after. First, David HaMelech made him the king. Then he had the dream. Meaning David, it was okay for David to nominate a 12 years old kid to take his place. He was 70 years old. He was 70 years old. And he nominated his son of Bathsheba, when he was 12 years old. Meaning he thought he's capable of doing the job. Of course, he had the Navi and all this, you know, fine, they will help him. But still, he's the king. He can kill, he can execute people. And he himself didn't have bar mitzvah. You obviously understand the difference between 12 years old today to 12 years old back then, 3,000 years ago, right? So, one thing we should know, if you come to the synagogue, is to pray, is to cry, is to open up the heart, is to make tshuva, is to listen to words of Torah. Everything in a synagogue must be 100% pure, positive, and spiritual. No food, no jokes, no problems, provocative clothing, no business talking, no fights, no arguments, no acts of disrespect. None of these things belong in a synagogue. They don't belong anywhere. But inside the synagogue, it's much, much, much worse. You come into my living room, in my own house, to do it in my face, inside the house of God. You couldn't have that chutzpah. So people who cannot control their talking, or that they go to a synagogue that everyone there talk, better to go to a different synagogue, even if it's not Sfaradi, or even if it's not Ashkenazi. It's different than your mentality, or different than what you brought up like. What difference does it make? So it's different accent. It's a little bit different custom, but at least nobody talks there. Somebody asked me about a state, a different state, not New York. He said, when I go there, I go into this synagogue, Sfaradi synagogue, and the people over there, They are mash. They make my blood boil. The way they disrespect, the way they talk in the middle of davening. When the rabbi speak, nobody cares. They make noise. I really, it kills me to pray there. Over there, it says there's an Ashkenazi shul, Bnei Torah, people that learn all day Torah. Over there, nobody talks because Bnei Torah, it's Bnei Torah. They understand the value of the prayers. What should I do? I say, of course, go to the Ashkenazi. What's the question? Right, as far as you're not yotzei lidechovah, it's a circus. You go to the Ashkenazim, you pray with the Ashkenazim. He said, but my father-in-law will be upset. I say, tell him in my name that he should also go with you to the Ashkenazim. He said, but he's one of the important people in the synagogue. Tell him to take you and him and go over there. It doesn't matter what his position over there. To save himself from a drowning boat. You got to save your life. Otherwise, you sink with them. You come to do it, you do it right. You don't want to do it right, don't do it at all. That's the rule. You understand? You want to drive, but you don't want to drive right. People will die. Don't drive at all. Either do it the right way or don't drive at all. You don't want to conduct business in the right way, don't do business at all. You don't want to learn Torah the real way, you're going to get crooked. If you learn incorrectly, or you learn a lot of nonsense that people spread today, not only won't help you, it will make a damage to your life. Damage. Teach you all kinds of nonsense that people teach how to believe. Someone sent me a little video of some speaker, becoming popular, the speaker. It says over there, he said over there, your wife doesn't want to go to the mikveh. So what? Why are you pressuring her? He said, she's not ready. Wait until she'll be ready. It's not the right way to put pressure on her. You fool, total retarded person, this guy. Without this, you cannot be with your wife 1 hour. That's the only thing that the Beit Din forced you to get divorced. And the Beit Din knows that Hashem cries for every couple that get divorced. She doesn't want to keep Shabbat. No Beit Din will force you to divorce her. At least minimum 2 years. They'll wait to see what's, maybe she will change. She doesn't want to eat kosher. They won't tell you to divorce her. She doesn't want to cook kosher in the house. They tell you, eat outside. Eat in a deli. Make yourself a sandwich with cream cheese. They won't give you permission to get divorced for it. Only one thing. Only one thing. She want to watch horrible things in the internet. They won't force you to get divorced. That's horrible. She's the mother of your children. She's becoming a monster. Not that fast they will tell you to divorce her. Let's try. Let's call her. Let's talk to her. She refused to go to the mikveh. They wait a month or two. They see she doesn't want to change her mind. Cannot be with her. Cannot touch her. It's isur karet. Right away, divorce. And she lose all her ketubah. He wrote to her $5 million in a ketubah. She will get five million rolls of toilet papers. Instead. That's also worth a lot.
It's also money.
Only in a joke she gets it. In reality, she gets nothing. Why? It's called Isha Moredet. Isha Moredet. A woman that rebels against her husband. But when she doesn't keep Shabbat, she's also moredet against Hashem. It's worse. That's still not, has nothing to do with your marriage with her. She's rebelling in many, many different things. She rebels against her boss, she rebels against her parents, and even she rebels against her husband by not keeping Torah and mitzvot. Because when we got married, she was keeping. It's true. But you can still be intimately with her, meaning you can still be like a man and a woman. Let's wait. But if you cannot be together, what marriage is about? You cannot. So what do you need there? What do you need? A roommate? Find a different roommate. You understand? And this fool is talking to the public. Now what do you think will happen from this stupid lecture that he gave? It's running all over, and most people don't understand. And now many women would watch it. You see? You look what the rabbi say. You cannot tell me to go to the mikveh. I'm not going anymore. Thousands of marriages will either break or the people would live by making the worst sins in the Torah every day. Being with your wife without mikveh is worse than being with your mother, in case you didn't know. It's a bigger sin. That's what the Torah says. And this genius is spreading this nonsense. Why is it? This is what happens when you listen to people that are not qualified to teach the correct way of the Torah. Very dangerous. Very dangerous. I'll give you an example. Sometimes the people are kosher. They're kosher. The big tzaddikim even. They're in a very high level. They makpid in every mitzvah. But they're also not good for you to follow. Why? They follow Kabbalah very strictly. It's not for ordinary people. It's only going to mess your life. Stay away from it. Kabbalah, it's not for ordinary people. Someone who has not been Torah for many years, learning in yeshiva all day, should not come near Kabbalah. It's a whole different channel. It's not for ordinary people. What is this? Learning Kabbalah, talking Kabbalah, everything he does is based on Kabbalah. All of a sudden in Shabbat he's wearing all white, special white yarmulke, this, what is this? You don't know how to wash your hands already, you don't know. You already became the Ben Ish Chai. That's my rabbi. For him it's good. He learned 20 years in yeshiva. He wants to be Ben Ish Chai. Let him be the Ben Ish Chai. I'm surprised that some of these speakers bichlal even teach ordinary people Kabbalah. Why do you even bring it up, bichlal? It should be completely forbidden to the public. Even in yeshivot, you have big talmidei chachamim that knows all the Gemara, all the Shulchan Aruch, and many of them don't touch Kabbalah. Is it mandatory? No. Is it the halacha? No. Do we posek based on that? No. If there is an argument between the Zohar and the Gemara, who should we follow? We follow the Gemara, we don't follow the Zohar. The Zohar is a holy book, of course. The people that live to the standard of Kabbalah are holy, of course. But what's better, to gamble and go there and then collapse and do nothing in the end? Let's first keep what we really have to. Shabbat, modesty, learning Torah. When we finish the whole Gemara, when we finish the Shulchan Aruch, when we know all the halachot, when we know all the minagim, when we perfectly fix our midot, if we'll still be alive, we'll open the Zohar and learn some Kabbalah. It's like someone who comes to medical school first day, he never saw Advil, and wants to enter the class that teach a brain surgery. What are you doing here? You just joined the school today. My teacher is a big doctor, he's a brain surgeon, so I'm coming to his class here. First, go check the blood pressure, how you check. What is this? Come to brain surgery, open heart surgery. You understand? Everything has to be logical in life. Most of it comes from ego. You should know that. It's all ego. All ego. Show off. It's all show off. Same thing people when they pray and they make all these faces and all these atzagot. It's all a show. They feel like they're in Broadway. Some of them open their eyes sometimes to check. Imagine a guy for 20 minutes, he goes with the faces and with the hands and he's clearing the cloud. And then he opens up the eyes and he sees the janitor. He's cleaning the floor, everyone left. All this show I'm making and no one is here already. You know, you want to hear the real rule? Remember this. Put everything I say on hold for a minute. Just this remember. If you want to know if to do it or not, first thing you have to check is if the biggest rabbis in the world do it or not. Who are the biggest rabbis in the world? Until 2 years ago, we had many. Now we don't have that much left. But we had many. We had Rav Ovadia Zatzal. We had Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul that passed a few years ago. We had a lot of great Gdolim. We have Baruch Hashem, Rav Vozner. We have Baruch Hashem. Today, who do we have? We have Rav Chaim Kanievsky. We have Rav Steinman. We have Rav Karelitz. We have Rav Sternbuch. Those are the top four in the world. And there are a few other big Rabbanim, Rav Mazuz, Faradi, that are very big. We have Rav Sofer, the Rosh Yeshivat Kaf HaChaim, giant in Torah, very anonymous. He's hiding. He's just as big as Rav Ovadia Yosef. He wrote 60 books. Very, very big, but he's hiding. He doesn't want to be a leader. He doesn't want to be a public figure. But he's very big in Torah. You take those big figures, those big giants, chachamim, and you see if they do it or not. They do it. For instance, now they came out with tzitziot a few years ago with blue. 2,000 years we didn't have blue. We didn't have the snail. We didn't have it. We didn't know which one is the snail, which one is the correct blue. All of a sudden, one person 15 years ago, something like that, started to publish it. We found the snail, now we know the blue, now it's an obligation to put it in a tzitzit. Maybe he's right. Possible, maybe they found the snail. Did you see Rav Chaim Kanievsky change his tzitzit? Rav Eliashiv changed his tzitzit? Rav Ovadia changed his tzitzit? Rav Sternbuch changed his tzitzit? Rav Steinman? None of them did it. You don't have permission to do it. Even if a local rabbi tell you to do it, forget about it. When Gdolei Ador will do it, then we'll know for sure it's the right one. When none of them did it, don't do it. They speak, you're not allowed to eat meat in Israel. Not allowed, not allowed, not allowed. Everything not allowed. You ask one of Gdolei Ador, you eat meat somewhere in Israel? Yes, Rav Chaim, where you buy meat? I buy over here. You're allowed to buy over there. Don't ask questions. If the big chacham eats meat from that place, you can count on him and eat over there, and you don't need to go in and do an investigation. It's good enough to count on what he does. I'm not talking someone local. I'm talking one of Gdolei Ador, if he eats over there. Where do you buy etrogim, Rabbi? They say most of the etrogim are not kosher. Only Yemenite for sure it's kosher. I buy from here. I know the Chazon Ish told us that this kind of tree is 100% etrogim. It's not mixed with lemon. So Rav Chaim, you're going to make bracha on this etrog? Yes, I also buy from here. Maybe when you come to Shamayim, in the end you'll find out it wasn't. It's not my problem. This is what the Torah says. We have to follow Gdolei Ador, Morei HaDerech. Kol asher yomru lecha tishma bekolam. Did you ever see Gdolei Torah go to Uman? Did you ever see one? You will never see. Did you ever see Gdolei Torah, real Gdolei Torah, learning in the books of those people? No, never. You will never find it by Rav Chaim Kanievsky, never by Rav Ovadia, never by Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul. As a matter of fact, one of his students opened a book in Porat Yosef, and Rav Ben Zion never ever threw a student from yeshiva in his life, except that boy. Told him, you have to leave the yeshiva today. Why? He didn't open a secular newspaper. He opened a holy book of a holy rabbi. Why threw him out of the yeshiva? That's not our ideology. Not every time someone will make up a new way, we're going to leave their 3,300 years of Torah that we have and we go to that direction. Did you see Rav Chaim Kanievsky went there? No. Rav Steinman went there? No. Rav Ovadia went there? Rav Ben Zion went? Rav Eliashiv went? Rav Shach went? Rav Karelitz went? Any one of Gdolei Ador ever went there? None. You're not allowed to go there. That's it. I'm just giving an example. In general, this is the way it should be. Remember, every time you have a doubt, this rabbi say allowed, this one not allowed, this one is good from there, this one says not good from there. When you see at least one Gdol Dor that follow that, you have who to count on. Ordinary teachers, they're not an indication if you're allowed or not. You have to only go by the giant chachamim. Today I told you, there's not that many left. That's why the Gemara say, En ben David ba, al shelo ichlu hachachamim min ador. One of the ways that Hashem will be forced to bring Mashiach, whether he wants or not, he won't have a choice. Because later he won't have who to bring Mashiach to. So one of the conditions in the Gemara is, ad sheichlu hachachamim min ador. There will not be any high scholars left from the generation, meaning no one to count on. The Gemara gives another example that a woman will come to the yeshiva with a chicken and ask if it's kosher, and no one will be able to tell for sure if it's kosher or not. We are very close to this. Look what's happening today. Kosher, not kosher. This rabbi is kosher. No, this one is taref. If I was Sfaradi, I would need it. It's the best one. He says it's taref. He says it's the best shchita. According to him, it's the best shchita. According to that one, it's mamash like eating dogs. No wonder they call it hot dogs. Now there is something new. New controversy. When we go on the airplanes, when we fly, we order kosher meal. Then they give you black coffee. What's wrong with black coffee? Black coffee, it's black coffee. Sugar is sugar. It doesn't need to be a special lecture, right? Guess what? They just found out. In Southwest, one studerherz told one rabbi that they heat their non-kosher meat in the water, the hot water pots, that they heat it in a machine, they put it inside the coffee pot. Before, there's no coffee inside, it's empty, they wash it. They put water, they put their pig, pork, hot dogs, and boil it inside. And then they wash it, and they give you tea and coffee from there. They need to eat their food. They bring their own sausages. How are they going to eat sausage? Tony. Tony, the studerherz. He needs his mother's sausage. She made him a ham sausage. How is he going to eat it? He doesn't have barbecue in a plane. How do you cook hot dogs in conditions like airplane? You boil them in water. How do you boil water? In a coffee machine. That's what's going on. Imagine, even hot water you cannot cake from a plane. Maybe you bring your own thermos from home with hot water.
What about Elal? Could Elal do the same things?
The answer probably yes, because the Israeli studerers, they're eating non-kosher, many of them at least. They don't care about kosher. So if they heat their hot dogs over there, most likely you don't want to count on it. Time is running out. We cover the synagogue. If you come, do it right. If not, don't come at all. Pray at home. At home, you can talk to the wall. The wall, he can listen to you. He doesn't need to pray. But you come to the synagogue, you don't bring little children. You don't bring little children. Women, I have to hear shofar, Rabbi. No, you don't. You don't need to hear shofar. You're a woman. Woman doesn't need to hear shofar. If someone from the neighborhood will come to your house and blow the shofar for the ladies, very nice, mitzvah. Obligation, 100% you don't have. Bringing the little children to run at 9 a.m. or 10 a.m. in a synagogue and disturb all the people and so much noise, it sounds like a bar mitzvah party. And they have to blow the shofar and everyone is angry now. The children screaming, running, mommy, everything like this. She needed to hear shofar, the Rebbetzin. And what happened? She comes supposedly to do mitzvah and make many people angry, fighting. Believe me, sometimes they fight even over it. Disturb people. People don't pay attention to the mitzvah. Do it. You have to do it right. Now one more thing before we finish. Life without faith, worth dying. It's not worth to live. If you don't have faith and strong confidence in Hashem, why living? Life is very miserable. There are some verses in the Tanakh that when people are worried and they think negative, that negative comes to them. Iyov say, when I fear the upcome, et asher yagorti bali. Because I think negative and I don't trust Hashem, all the bad that I was worried that will come to me ended up coming to me. Don't get the wrong impression. If a person thinks I'm making sins, who knows what punishment Hashem would give me if I don't do tshuva, that's positive. You're allowed to think like that. You should. If you don't think like that, you don't have Yirat Shamayim. But some people think positive, it will be positive. No, it won't. It will be more negative. You're going to murder, you're going to bury people, you will steal, you will not pray, you will cheat, you will do all the horrible things, and you think positive? On the way to Gehenom, you can think positive as much as you want. We'll see if he's going to save you from one of the chambers over there. The person has to think positive, meaning I trust Hashem that it's all for my good. That's all. That's what it means to think positive. That even when I lost money, it's for my own good. Even when I'm single, it's for my own good. I probably do things wrong that Hashem is keeping me like that. Many of the single people, they're not honest. connect them to a lie detector, and you see that they won't be able to be married one day. And Hashem is doing a wonderful chesed that He keeps them single. Look at their behaving. They cannot live with another person in the same room. They can't. They're too selfish. They're too inconsiderate. They don't care. They make noise. He comes at night. His wife's going to try to sleep after all day with the kids. Noise, this, dark, lights on, dark, things falling. Moshe, do you mind? Be quiet. I had a long day. Oof. Who are you to tell me what to do? Why did I need to get married? I was alone here. I did whatever I want. Now you're only telling me not. Yes, no. Or the other way around. Until now, everyone was bowing down to her. Now she has someone else to report to. She cannot live with another man. Women that are addicted to the Facebook, 500 members, friends on a page, all day like this. She can be married. She can be a wife. She can cook dinner. She can give love to her husband when she has 500 admirers. Wow, such a picture. Stunning. You look amazing. 2 minutes later, her husband has a hard day. He comes home. She doesn't want to look at him. Why? Tony just gave her a compliment. She cannot. It's destroyed. Why am I getting married? Why? To eat the heart more? I know it's funny, but it's very sad. It's sad. It's funny at the same time. There's one person, from time to time, they're leaving me recorded messages, questions. There's not one time that the messages were playing and I did not hear at least three times, bzz, bzz, bzz. So one time I couldn't stop myself and I say, what is this, Ma? Every 5 seconds you get a message? So he said, it's the groups, Rabbi. I'm in many groups. He can be a husband, now he has a wife to take care of her. Groups, that's his life. Every 3 seconds a joke, a message, something. So Hashem is doing him a chesed. First be a human being, then we'll talk about marriage. Some husbands, flashy, loud, alcohol, every party, dancing on the chairs, on the table. Calm down, you're embarrassing your wife. You see vodka. Speaking about vodka, one guy, I won't say from what country, you figure it out yourself. One guy, he said to his wife in the morning, pour for me a glass of vodka. So she said to him, hey, it's only 8 a.m. So, okay, you can add cornflakes to it. No problem. Breakfast time. The idea, Rabotai, marriage is a partnership. In partnership, you don't do whatever you want. You join a partnership with another person. You have limitations. You have obligations. You cannot keep up with those limitations and obligations. You're not allowed to form a partnership. And in partnership in a business, the limitations are not the end of the world. All you have to do is not to steal from him, to respect him, to say hi. Each one will give their heart for the business, and that's more or less that. That's it. Nothing else he can tell you why you wore this collar jacket. What is it, his business? Bottom line, 4 or 5 obligations you have, and the partnership can work. But in marriage, it's hundreds of things, hundreds of obligations. It's much, much harder than partnership in a business. You understand? If a person doesn't want to change before he gets married, better not getting married. But Rabbi, I have an obligation to have children. Pruvu, no? That's the mitzvah of the parasha. Pruvu, when you can raise children. Now when you will destroy them, the way you live right now, you'll destroy them. They all will be abused mentally. One after the other. Well, you know what happened to kids when you abuse them? They turn into monsters. All the serial killers in history, it's their parents' fault. 99.9% to be safe. Check with FBI. When they put their profile together, it's always the father molesting, or the mother, or abuse, or putting them down, or laughing at them in public, or some kind of a tragedy that happens. Sometimes it wasn't their fault. I correct what I said. It could be an innocent mistake. They didn't do it on purpose, but something that happened that got them into their subconscious, and from now they have to murder.
Sometimes it's a person's nature.
Everyone's nature that was born in Mazal Ma'adim is to kill. The Gemara say, but it depends how you direct your nature. You can be a mohel, or a...
It's not the parents' fault.
No, right. That's why I say, correct what I say. Sometimes it's innocent mistake. Innocent mistake. They did something to the kid, and then later on it reflects in their personality. Also schizophrenia. They don't know all the reason why it happened one day. A kid can be perfectly normal 20 years, and all of a sudden it comes. And they have split personality. One minute he's a man, and then he's a woman. It's very interesting. Do you know there's ways, they develop ways, it's a whole science. We are not psychologists or psychiatrists, but in the Torah, there are many, many Talmidei Chachamim that were very big psychiatrists and psychologists. Bezrat Hashem, if I have time, I will start soon a series about psychology, according to the Torah. That you can tell the difference between what's real psychology and what's nonsense psychology, who destroyed people even more. Some of the psychologists or psychiatrists, they make bigger damages to the people than what they help them. They push them into chemical, all kinds of medication, all kinds of things like this. There are ways, according to the Torah, to solve problems, sometimes much easier than medication. Sometimes there's no solution. You have to take medication. After all, who invented these medications? Hashem. Rabbi, but why do I have to take medication? If Hashem wants me to be like that, that means that's how I have to be. Not true. Hashem made sicknesses, which is a curse and punishment to humanity, but he also gave cure. How many people got cured by doctors? They were supposed to die. Surgery, balloon in the heart, they give them extra life, cataract, clean their eyes from not seeing. There's a lot of examples. Even glasses is a cure. It makes you able to read or to see. Without it, you cannot function. Simple thing, costs $1 in a 99-cent store, and you can read for $1. Without it, you're worthless. My cousin was a student of Rav Benzion Abba Shaul. So about 15 years ago, he told me that he wrote a diary. That he was attached to him for 12 years, and he wrote a diary. And say he doesn't have permission to publish this diary, because Rav Benzion Abba Shaul said that he has only one son, Eliyahu Abba Shaul, and all his books has to go through his son. Meaning his son inherit the copyrights of all his, or everything that connects to him. And my cousin is a very honest person, even though it's not his book, it's his book, he wrote a diary on him. But he doesn't want to publish it while his son is still alive, to make him upset, so he's keeping it. But he showed me some parts. One of the things from his diary was a very interesting story. He said that he was in a room with him, and one person came into the room with a pile of papers like this. Lots of papers written with a pen, like this. And he said to him, Rabbi, we want to publish a book about the shiurim that you gave in Porat Yosef. All the shiurim that you gave us over the years. I just want to go over with you the pages to confirm that it's all yours. Maybe it's from different speakers. You know, it's different classes there. He said to him, read, I don't have my glasses. And he said to me, my cousin, the person read three or four words. I don't remember if he said three or four. That's it. Not even a sentence. He started to say the first three or four words, and he told him, it's not mine. And that was 20 years after. 20 years ago, he said few words. He already knew that's not my shiur. the way the mind works. It was enough for him to know it's not mine. You know, in the internet, there is a, on YouTube, there is a video. An atheist is making a school to Rabbi Mizrahi. You hear about it or no? They took one Israeli guy to imitate me. it's not me. Someone with Israeli accent, the voice is completely different. I don't know how some people even really think it's me. And they make a conversation between some kind of a professor against the faker. I had hundreds of thousands of views. More than the real lectures I give. When it's poison to murder someone with a lie, the Satan sends a lot of viewers. Baruch Hashem. That's how it goes. Life without the faith are no life. Happiness, is it in the hand of the person or is it in the hand of Hashem? What do you think? I know it's in my hand if to hold the book now or to throw it on the floor. It's in my hand, right? I'm choosing what to do. I know it's in my hand. It's in my hand if to record a lecture or not to agree to record a lecture. It's in my hand, right? What to wear, it's in my hand. What to eat, it's in my hand. Many, many things, it's in my hand or it's in your hand, everyone with his own life. To be happy or sad, is it in my hand or it's not in my hand? It's a decree. It's a destiny. It's my fortune. What do you think? There are three options. One, yes, it's in my hand 100%. Two, no, nothing, it's in my hand. And three, it's a combination of both. Some it's in my hand, some it's not in my hand. I say the first one is all in your hand. The lady here said, it's all in your hand. Everyone agree with her or no?
Yes.
No, some was in your hand, some was in your hand.
He say, some is in your hand, some is not in your hand. Who think nothing is in your hand? Two people think the Muslim way. The Muslim way. It's all min Allah. Everything is from Hashem. Nothing is in your hand. Okay.
My answer is nothing is in your hand, but what is in your hand is the reaction to that.
Now you change your answer, you know, completely.
Yeah.
Okay, I got you now.
I changed my position, Your Honor.
Yeah. No problem. Just next time, don't talk before I allow you. Otherwise, I'll call you in order. So now,
no, I think Hashem hurts you.
You, as usual, always right, Baruch Hashem. And the answer is 100% in your hand to be happy or no. So how come 99.9% of the people in the world are upset and depressed and sad at least part of the time? The answer is because they were never brought up or educated or followed the truth of life. As a result of that, it caused them to be angry and upset almost every minute of their life. Meaning, 70 or 80 years of suffering and aggravation could have been prevented by learning few good books. It will change your entire life. You choose if to be happy or not. How? Knowledge. If you're ignorant, if you're uninformed about the truth of the Creator, about the psychology of the mind, about the consequences of your actions, you never learned about it. Therefore, you live your life like everything is destiny, coincidence. Like a Russian roulette. Russian roulette. It's coincident. Luck, like they say in Israel, Eze mazal. I was lucky in America. Lucky day. Lucky number. Lucky decision. Lots of words like that, which are all illegal. There's no such thing. So let's, how does a person understand what I'm about to say? Let me try to clarify it. The Torah says, "Yihi chasdecha Hashem aleinu kaasher ichalnu lach." Hashem, we know your kindness on us is based on how much we are hoping for it. Hashem say to each one of us, I'm going to teach you the secret of life. And that's what I'm about to do now. Pay attention. The secret of life is, the more you rely on me, the more I'm going to do for you, for free. The more you rely on yourself, the more I would leave you. And you're going to have to do it on your own. So now, all you have to know, that I have to do nothing here. Hashem told me to do a little bit effort, meaning to make a living. So I make a little effort. I open a window for Hashem to throw me the parnasa, the living. And the rest, I throw on Hashem. So what's better? To throw on Hashem 1% and to keep 99% on my head? Or to keep 1% on my head and throw 99% in Hashem? Let's throw everything on Hashem. Is it legal? Absolutely yes. It says, Ashlech Yahavcha al Hashem, V'hu Yechalkelecha. Throw everything on Hashem, and He will do everything for you. Yekalkel otcha. He will take care of all your needs. Not only money, clothing, place to live, car, medicine, insurance, whatever you need. People that do not understand this formula, they'll kill themselves for nothing. If you remember once I told you a mashal, a parable, about a poor person that did not eat for 2 days. Remember this or no? And he was looking for a place to give him food before he died. That's it. Another hour or two, he will be dead. So he came and he saw a big, nice, fancy house with a nice mezuzah. He knocked on the door. A rich Jew opened. Can I help you? I'm starving. Maybe you give me something to eat? So of course, I'll give you a meal you never ate in your whole life. See how the homeless person looks. I'm going to give you a food. Nobody gets such food. Yeah, please, thank you. No, not for free. I'm a businessman. You're going to have to work a little bit for me before. To work? What do I have to do? I'll take you to my garage, so it looks like a zoo. All a big mess. Take everything from the shelves, clean the shelves, put all the paint here, all the electric things over here, all the clothing over here. Here, he gives him instruction, work for 2 hours, make the garage spotless, sweep the floor, come upstairs, you get the meal of your life. Eat as much as you can, fill up your pocket, no problem. The poor man say, how do I know if I'll find a place to eat? I can be dead in a few hours. I have no choice. It's either this or I'll be dead. Okay, I agree to the deal. He walk, he made the place look like a pharmacy. He comes back up. Okay, yeah, you actually did a good job. Very good, you deserve your meal. You see this house across the street? Yes. Go across the street, just open the door. It's open, it's not locked. The food is all ready for you. You have everything you want. Fish, meat, chickens, fruits, desserts, coffee, tea, juices, nuts, whatever you like. Candy. Eat as much as you can. Put in your pocket, fill up your shoes even. Just enjoy. The poor man said, thank you very much. Great to do business with you. He runs quickly across the street. It's not sure, 100%. It's not fooling me. He's going to lock the door now. It's there, his heartbeat. Imagine if he fooled me. You know, it's very interesting. People don't trust Hashem, but they trust strangers from the newspaper. When they get a job, they come to a store. So the old boss say, you're going to work here on a register? $12 an hour. No problem. He works 6 days. $500-$600 by the end of the week. Maybe he's going to fire you and won't pay you. What are you going to do now? How do you know it's going to pay you? It can make you work 6 days. When they come time, hey, you made me a damage in a restaurant. Get out of here before I don't know what I'm going to do to you. You trust him to pay you, right? But some people are taking advantage on people. They won't pay. But when it comes to Hashem, they're not sure. So the poor man ran across the street. He opened the door. Wow. Dogs. Liver. Chicken, steaks, Amazing. I never ate like this for my bar mitzvah. He goes inside, ta ta ta, he's eating. Eating and eating and eating and eating. Quick, before maybe somebody changed his mind. By the time he was stuffed, he put in his pockets, everything, he grabbed. Now he's about to leave. One person from upstairs. I never saw in my life such an ungrateful person like you, he said to the poor guy. He looked up at him, said, who are you? Why am I ungrateful? You've been eating here more than five people could have ate. And even say, you don't even say thank you and you're about to leave? So first of all, I didn't see you. And second of all, why do I even owe you a thank you? I earned it. I worked very hard for this. So you're not doing me a favor. When I pay for it, I have to say thank you. It's mine. I paid for it. He said to him, you paid for it? First time in my life I see you. When did you ever pay me for the food? He said to him, what do you mean? I walk across the street 2 hours like a dog. Said to him, he also fooled you, this crook. And he said to him, what do you mean? He said, there's a guy who lives across the street. Every time a poor person knocks on his door, he tricked him. He makes him clean his garage and he sends him over here. This is a Bet Tamchui over here. We feed the poor here. Everyone who wants can come and eat. So he said to him, you are actually saying to me that I could have just come here to eat without the 2 hours walk that I walk? He said, of course. He was banging his head to the table. This is us. In this parable, the person on the top is Hashem. The crook across the street, the rich guy, is the Yetzer Hara, the evil inclination. And the poor guy, it's us. We have a way to come and eat and Hashem serve us and take care of all our need without doing anything. Or we can go and earn it, meaning go to college, working, killing ourselves, first shift, second shift, working on Shabbat, night shift, working on Yom Tov, thinking is making money. You work, you make money, of course. They pay you by the hour, by the day, by the week. But the goal, Hashem said to you, you don't need to kill yourself. All you have to do is a little bit effort, like walking into the Bet Tamchui. Come in and eat. As long as you trust that I will feed you. Trust me, you not worry, I'll do everything for you. So what do you see? Almost nobody trusts Hashem. That's why we have to kill ourselves like slaves, like the guy in a story. Do you understand the point here? All you have to do is to change the switch in your mind. I'm not going to be a slave. To get what I can get for free. How you can get it for free? Realize it belongs to your father. It belongs to your father. Imagine the son of Bill Gates. He doesn't know how many businesses his father owns. He doesn't know. Who knows? He can own thousands of businesses. So he goes on a job interview. You know, so what? Just because his last name is Gates, it means he's the son of Bill Gates? Okay, you hired. He walks over there, he's killing himself, working. At the end of the week, they paid him $10,000. And then one person said to him, well, what's your name? My name is, who's your father? Bill. You're crazy? He owned this whole building. Your father owned the building. How foolish he would feel. Well, I have to go and work for the manager who actually worked for my father. This is us. One time, there was a teacher in our yeshiva. His father is a very rich man, very rich man. But his father, if you see him, you will never ever know he's rich. He did everything he can in his life to be the most simple person on earth. He lives in a very ordinary, simple house. He drives a simple minivan. Dress very simple, look like ordinary Haredi, could be look like Avrech. And is a multi-millionaire, perhaps a billionaire. He owned many buildings in London, big buildings, real estate went up, triple his money, became very rich. He sponsored 10 yeshivot in Israel, him and his brother, the partner, 10 big yeshivot, they pay for everyone. It looks very simple for himself, very, very simple. One time, there was a kid that had cancer. He brought up his family, father and mother. He rented for them a house in Muncie for $2,600 a month for a year. He paid all the rent, he paid all the flights, he paid all the food, he gave them money to live. While they taking the boy for treatment in a cancer department, all their expenses he was paying. And Mamash is like one of hundreds or thousands of things he's doing. His son used to teach in our yeshiva. He's Ashkenazi Rebbe. Back then he was young. I'm talking to you about 20 years ago. One day he comes to me and he said, can you do me a favor? I said, what? He said, can you find out from the Rosh Yeshiva who pays my salary here? I said, what do you mean? He said, I know my father. He told me go and teach in yeshiva, but he probably gives the money to the Rosh Yeshiva from behind my back. I said, no, and let's say he does it. So what's the big deal? No, I don't want to accept money from my father. His ego. I want to make it on my own. His father worth $100 million or $500 million, whatever it is. He wants to give him money in a different direction. So he tells him, go teach in yeshiva. Now the Rosh Yeshiva doesn't need him. He's not going to pay him $2,000 or $3,000 a month 20 years ago to teach. But since the father giving the salary, why not having a free Rebbe, no? Another Rebbe that you have working for you for free. Why do I care? Of course, it's good. He knows how to teach. But this guy is clever. He's already thinking, probably my father set it up. So I went and found out. It was true. So I went to him and said, no. He said, don't worry. Your father don't pay your salary. And he stayed in yeshiva and taught for a few years until he went to Israel and became a businessman. If I tell him your father is paying your salary, his ego, what would happen? He would leave the yeshiva. So the yeshiva lose a teacher that teach people, Gemara, the Baalei Tshuva. Plus, he won't make it on his own. He wasn't exactly such a great businessman back then. You understand? How do I know? Today he went to Israel to become a businessman. And one of his workers told me he's barely surviving. His father sponsored hundreds of families, and he still drives a 1980 car and live very poor. Why? I don't want to accept from my father. Also ego. And we also like that with Hashem. We also like that. The difference between him and us, he knows it's from his father and he doesn't want to take. We don't know that we can get it from our father. That's the difference. The moment we understand that all you have to do is to throw everything on Hashem, and never to worry. Your cleaning lady left you, don't cry to your husband 2 weeks. Just, Hashem, you know what I need help. Help me out, finish. You'll take care of it. Before you realize it will be fine. What happened if it's not fine? It's time for you to clean toilets. What's the problem? What? That's what Hashem wants. Sylvia went back to Honduras. It's time for Miriam to pick up her sleeves and start cleaning. No, I was just joking. Relax. So if you didn't get a new cleaning lady, what happened? It's because you worry. You worry that you won't have. The whole point is, how do you know if a person trusts Hashem or not? If he worries about it or not? That's how you know. You worry that your children won't get married? You're going to have to work to find them shiduchim, not Hashem. Kill yourself for it. The shatchanim, offer 10,000 up front. Because you worry. You're not worried? Why are you not running to find shiduchim to your kids? It's not my problem. It's Hashem's problem. What is it my business? What do you mean? It's your children. I did my shtadlut. I registered them here for this shatchan, this shatchanim. That's it. What do you want me to do? Run and knock on doors? Take my children and put them in a window of Macy's? What do you want me to do? I just had a flashback from 25 years ago when I was still in business. One old man, perhaps he's not alive by now, Scottish, from Scotland. His name was Graham Martin Brown, non-Jew. Showed up in my office. I was 20-something years old. Back then, he was 75 to 80, back then. It's amazing today when I look back at it, how people 80 years old are still are anxious and full of energy one day to become millionaires. The hunger that he had to make it, he came into the office and he said to me, I want to do this, I want to do that. He knew tons of business. He knew he has degrees, all this, you know. And the Israeli guy sits in the office, me and him. I want you to come with me to this meeting. We're going to do this. We're going to make 5% commission from all their business. You and me will split it. You will give the service. I will make the connection. I said, well, what do I have to lose? I make some money on the side. Why not? We decided to meet. And so then he told me this. Now, why I had a flashback. He told me, if you're going to make that going, I will kiss your hand in the window of Macy's. Meaning in front of the whole world. That's why I remember this now. So and the next day he made a meeting with me to meet me in Manhattan. I come to the place, young Israeli guy, a few years after the army. And he showed up, guess what? With a skirt, a mini skirt. You know, the Scottish people, they wear skirts, you know. I look at this 8 years old man coming with a skirt. I say to myself, oh, I'm gonna walk 20 blocks now in Manhattan with this guy. Imagine if somebody will take a Baruch Hashem, back then people didn't have cameras in their phone. Imagine someone would recognize me and take a picture with me and him walking on the street. So I was trying to walk very fast. That I won't be in Manhattan, there's millions of people, no one would know I have connection with him. I was walking very fast and the poor old man is chasing me. Let's conclude. The conclusion, when it comes to emunah, life can be really great. When it comes to remedy, to medicine, many of the worry that we have, we worry and worry and worry, it stresses us out. It takes away the pleasure of life. It brings a lot of sadness. People are eating their heart nonstop. Fights, aggravation, lawsuits, police, courts, fighting with neighbors, fighting with the whole world, all comes from one source. One button is off in a system. The button of emunah, it's not working. Turn it on. The way to turn it on is to learn about it and to listen to lectures about it every day. Every day. In my website alone, I assume that you have at least 10 lectures just about faith and confidence in Hashem. All you have to do is go to divineinformation.com. You have a search box. Put over there three words. One, faith. That will come. A few lectures about faith. Second, confidence. And third, write the word emuna. E-M-U-N-A. Those three words, you're going to find many lectures about these subjects. Any subject you want, you can find like that. You want to find ego, pride. Put words that connect to it. How do we name the lectures? Like you would name it. We have to come up with names that relates to the subject. Pride, ego, you know, words like this. And you find anger. You put anger. You find lectures about anger. Proofs. You want proofs. You click proofs. Many lectures about proofs would come. Also, we have a section for beginners. In my website, you have a section with separated lectures for complete beginners. Torah and science, the purpose of life, life after death, the debate, you know, a lot of lectures for complete beginners. Don't have to search from thousands of lectures. Just go to the beginners. You're gonna see over there. It's all very easy on the main page. You click on the menu on the beginners, and you're gonna find a lot of lectures. You have friends and relatives that are not religious. Send them over there. For the beginners, just. How am I going to call this lecture? Something to do with faith. Faith. Faith or emunah. Yeah. Now, one more thing to announce. Baruch Hashem, we already have this Konki flash drive for all the lectures I gave are, that are recorded in Hebrew. All of them on one flash drive, 32 gigabytes. Hundreds of hours of films and lectures, all in one tiny device. Tiny little device. Wait, patience. This, like this. Small device like this. Hundreds of films and lectures. You click it, plug it in your car. You can listen for years. Or in your phone. It has a connection on the other side to a cell phone. You don't need to waste data. You have lectures non-stop. You can put your earpiece when you're in the subway, when you run, when you're in the street. So that's one thing. The English, Baruch Hashem, is ready. First one that we made, I wasn't happy from the quality. Send it back. Now they send a better quality. It's ready. In 2 weeks, we're going to get the first shipment. We already put it last night on the website, or this morning. It's available already for orders. We will start ship them in 2 weeks from now. So for $20, 32 gigabytes, you can have thousands of lectures on one device. It will save you a lot of money on the CDs, but the CDs will be a lot more. And it's very convenient. You don't have to carry boxes and CD gets scratched. It's very easy. You plug it in. It's also in the right order. From the beginning to more advanced. Meaning, if you have non-religious people, it will be the nicest gift. Very cheap. You give it to people that you care about. They plug it in. They begin to listen to Torah and science, preparation for eternal life, Shabbat, the laws of repentance. Do you know what change you can make in the life of friends? You can save souls like this. Instead of buying tons of CDs and give them, you can now order that and give it. My opinion, the CDs will always remain the best thing ever. But soon the cars won't have CD players. That's it. Another year or two, they're changing the new models. We were forced to make it. I could have done it 3-4 years ago. People started to tell me, why don't you make a USB flash drive? Well, as long as all cars have CDs, why we need it? It's better this, you give a person a CD, 30 hours of lectures, and you give it to him and he plays it in a car and it's fantastic. Now we don't have a choice. If we won't do it in a year or two, we won't have one to offer. So we have this, Baruch Hashem. Everyone who wants, go on my website, divineinformation.com, click on order CDs, and that's in that section. Any questions before we finish? Oh, very good. Someone that wants to order tefillin, there are different levels of tefillin. I get a tefillin for about half a price than what they worth in the stores here, directly from Yerushalayim. Someone who cannot afford tefillin at all, contact me. Most of the time I can give them tefillin for free. It's not the highest level, but it's kosher. As long as the Jew that wants to put tefillin won't be left without this option. You understand? And even if we don't have sponsor, we'll find sponsor. I'll make an announcement in one of the next lecture after I get the person that needs tefillin. And usually people run to donate. For tefillin, it's not hard to get donations. To make people religious is very difficult to find donations. Very difficult. Why? Because it's the greatest profit. Endless. For eternity. For local mitzvot, such as tefillin, such as Arba'at Aminim, such as money for Sukkah, such as for food for Shabbat, it's much, much easier. Because it's a one-time thing. Even tefillin that he's going to put every day for 5 minutes, it's still one mitzvah a day. It's important, very important mitzvah. It's one of the three covenants, but it's one time a day. But if you make a person religious, every second of his life and his children and grandchildren forever and ever, constantly they're doing mitzvot and it all comes to your account. It's billions. For that, it's very difficult to collect money. Because the Satan will fight with the rich people to prevent it, no matter what. But for ordinary mitzvot, it's easy to collect. So if someone cannot afford tzitzit, tefillin, we can find him sponsor. It's no problem. Any questions before we finish? Yes.
Rabbi, what's the best type of Torah to learn to defeat the Yetzer Hara?
The best Torah to learn to defeat the Yetzer Hara is Musar, ethic. The word for it in English, the best word I have is ethics. Musar, meaning words of the sages and the prophets to rebuke us to make tshuva. Many of the things you can learn a lot of things, but it doesn't have musar in it. So you gain knowledge, but it doesn't change you as a person. But when you learn about how bad it is to be proud or angry or selfish or lazy, and it wakes you up to start changing your personality, that's the purpose of life. You came to the world with negative traits, and you have to leave the world without them. And the way to do it is by learning a lot of Torah, especially Musar. However, when you learn Gemara and you break your head, it purifies the soul. The soul gets to a higher level spiritually. And therefore it opens the heart of the people that even a little Musar will make a big impact. If you don't learn Gemara, you don't learn Torah, you just hear Musar, you need to hear a lot of Musar to change. But if you learn in Yeshiva, all day Gemara and Chumash and Navi, whatever you learn, even 15 minutes a day Musar is good. Because it penetrates directly. Why? Because the soul, it's like it's soft. It absorbs. You understand? That's the power of the Torah. It purifies the soul. That's the answer to your question. Yes.
What does the rabbi think of
Hasidut? Hasidut, it's something that was invented 200 and change years ago. 100 years we did not have Hasidut. Hasidut was already in Judaism in general. The Baal Shem Tov collected certain things and turned it into something called Hasidut movement. Hasidut could be very good for some people. Very good. It can bring them close to Hashem. It's also involved with music and spirituality and gathering together around the Rebbe. It's very interesting. Some people, that's the way they need. It's very good, productive for their Avodat Hashem. Some people don't need it. They need the rational Gemara and Litvish style. It's all the mind. They don't need the L'chaim, they don't need the Rebbe, the singing, the dancing, the opposite. For them, it's taking them away from the Avodat Hashem. So it depends on the nature of a person. But one thing I promise you, the Hasidut of the Baal Shem Tov and the Hasidut of today are completely two different things. If you learn the real Hasidut, for instance, one of the things the Baal Shem Tov was talking a lot about and also made an example to his followers is to live the most simple life. Not to be flashy, not to live in mansions, not to drive fancy cars, not to have shamashim everywhere. None of that show. And some of the big heads of Hasidut in today's in the world, living totally the opposite of the idea. Meaning more like a king than a Rebbe that is living barely and eating and drinking water and all his life is Torah and Yirat Shamayim. The real original Hasidut, great blessing. But as long as you go to the original Hasidut, not some of the Hasidut that all kinds of fools make today. They push a lot of nonsense and things that are coming from Christianity into today's and they call it Hasidut. That's not Hasidut, that's stupidity. For instance, Hashem has no interest that Jews will torture themselves to do tshuva. One day a year, yes, Yom Kippur, that's it. Ve-Yom Kippur ve-initem et nafshotechem. You don't have to torture yourself to be tzaddik. The opposite, you have to learn a lot of Torah, you have to be happy in your life. The Gemara says, certain things make a person happy. You have to eat healthy. You don't have to torture yourself. If you're in a very high level, you want to be a very big Talmid Chacham, it's a different story. Pat b'melach tochal, like Pirkei Avot say. But ordinary people, you take away everything from their life. What do you think will happen to them? That's Christianity. The Christians invented an idea that to be holy, you have to suffer. That's why the priests, they cannot get married. They cannot have children, but they don't realize that it contradicts the Torah. The Hashem says, I want people to get married. I want men to live with a woman together, not to be alone. I don't want the women to be alone, and I don't want the men to be alone. The ratio in the world that there are more women than men. More women than men. A few years ago, I checked the statistic. 105 women to every 100 Jewish men. If it's correct or not, I don't know. That's the statistic that was published by the Jewish agencies. In case it's true, it means for every 100 people on the street, every 100 men, there's extra 5 women. So for 1,000 men, there are 50 women that will not have a shidduch. For 10,000 men, there will be 500 women that do not have shidduch. For 100,000 men, there will be 5,000 women that do not have shidduch. For 1,000,000 men, there will be 50,000 women that do not have shidduch. 50,000 women. We have at least 1,000,000 Jewish men. At least we have about 5,000,000 men, right? Jewish men in the world. You do the math. It's 250,000 of women that cannot find shidduch. There's not enough men in the world. The Torah gave this the answer to it, that men used to marry more than one woman. He has one woman, and he can marry another woman. Here, one live over there. Back in the time, it was realistic. It's not the case for the last 1,000 years. It's not happening. At least by the European world, it stopped a long time ago. By the Sfaradim, it stopped 2 generations ago. There was the solution that Hashem wanted everybody to have a soulmate. Even if a woman couldn't find one husband, she would be a second wife, as better than to be alone. The Gemara in Masechet Kiddushin say, a woman will do everything she can to be married, even if she doesn't like so much the men. It will bring a lot of problems later on, especially today. But the Gemara teach you the psychology of a woman. I rather living with a man that I don't love so much, is not so great, than to stay alone and stay by my parents until I'm 50. You understand? Meaning that's what Hashem wants. That's the way the psychology of the man and the woman is. But the Christian invented a new thing. You want to be holy, you have to stay alone. That's why they do all the things they do. And if you hear the news. Why? Because it's not realistic to be a man and live all your life without having a wife. It's not realistic. Not to talk about the sins and other things that people would do. The Torah is the answer to everything. The problem with we have today, people inventing new ways. You want to be connected to Hashem? The only way is to connect to this rabbi that is buried over here. That's 100% Christianity. 100% Avodah Zarah. 100%. It's a big crime. Do you know how many thousands of Jews follow this? There's no way to connect to Hashem without that specific one. What about all the other big tzaddikim? I don't care. Only this one will connect me to Hashem. But he's hundreds of years dead already. Maybe his books will connect you to Hashem. But he can connect you to Hashem. That's how they believe. Like the Christians. They took JC and made him... he can do everything he wants. He will take our sins. He'll connect us to God. He will save us from hell. JC Mamash is a hocus pocus solution. I'll finish with a joke. One person had a parrot, and the parrot used to make long distance call. Back in the time, it was very expensive. He called China. For hour, the phone is on. His owner came in the end of the month, thousands of dollars phone bills. He said to the parrot, "You're the only one here. No one else used the phone. Stop playing with the phone. Next time you'll do it, I will hang you on the wall with 2 nails, with your wings like that." And the parrot, you know, he continued with his tricks. The owner came and he stuck him on the wall with 2 nails. Then he looked to the other side of the wall and saw JC is also hanged. So he said to JC, "Oh, you hang on the wall? How many years you are hanged like that?" He told him 2,000 years. He said, "Wow, who knows how much long distance you made? 2,000 years you hang there. How much long distance you made?" You understand? Bottom line, Hasidut back in the time of the Baal Shem Tov or Baal HaTanya, fantastic. For some people, it makes them very good and spiritual, no problem. By the way, the books of the Hasidut are in a very high level. It's not for ordinary people, they don't understand. Try to understand Tanya the real way, it's very difficult. You have to be knowledgeable in a lot of Torah to understand it. Or even Likutei Moharan of Rabbi Nachman Mbrestler, it's very deep. Most people, they're imagining that they understand it. Imagining. They don't understand that. Some of these books of the Hasidut are mainly based on Kabbalah. Our people, ordinary people, would understand it without learning years of Kabbalah by the greatest Mekubalim. It's very difficult. They pretend they understand. They want to be a part of the group. Speaking about Sfirot, speaking about this. I promise you, one of them have no idea what he's talking about. They're all imagining, like I will try to give a speech in Chinese. Pretending. Wah, 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 cha, wah, wah. People who don't understand Chinese, they think I speak beautiful Chinese. I had an uncle like this. He used to pretend that he speaks Italian. Until one time an Italian guy came. What is he saying? You understand? Yes. Depend. A girl turn a guy off and she doesn't want a shidduch who doesn't have a beard, usually she's a chabadnikit. By chabad, the beard is the most important thing. You don't have a beard, then nobody would like to go on a shidduch with you until she's off the derech. This is the way of Kabbalah. Chabad follow a lot of Kabbalah. Hasidut in general is very important, the beard, because it comes from Kabbalah. According to the Pshat, Shulchan Aruch, no obligation whatsoever to have a beard at all. Just not to shave with a razor. That's what the Torah says. But in Hasidut, it's very important. The Zohar has a whole chapter of Rabbi Shimon speaking about the oil who comes on the beard, and the beard is Tzinorot HaShefa and opens the brain. You understand? Fine. And Tehillim, the Zohar explained that. Rabbi Shimon is speaking about the... But this is when we do the Tashlich, the Sfaradim. The Tashlich of the Sfaradim is based on the Zohar. It's Tikunim, Rabbi Shimon. You see, he's speaking about the beard, the sodot, the secrets of the beard. Because it comes from Hasidut, it's very important, the beard over there. So you already know in advance. If your person knows he doesn't have a beard and they're offering him a girl that she's Chabadnikit or she's from Hasidut, to begin with, he knows they don't belong together. It's different ideology. Many of the people try, when there's two different groups with different ideology, to begin with, it doesn't have a lot of chance. To begin with, that's a mistake, and they just get aggravated for nothing. Person has to know his kind. Baalei tshuva. Technically, according to the Gemara, they even hire from birth. But that's not the situation in the world today. The way the from birth looks at Baalei tshuva as a second-class citizen. You ask me if it's right or wrong, the answer is wrong. You ask me why they do it if it's wrong, they have a point. Some of the Baalei tshuva made the movement of tshuva smells not so great with their behaving, with their style, with the way they talk, with the way they dress, with the things that they do. Some of the religious people from birth, they're afraid that their daughter will end up with a Tim Honi like that and all kinds of weirdos. So everything has a reason. But we have to check every case specifically. We cannot generalize. You cannot generalize against Persian or Yemenite or Moroccans or Ashkenazi or Hasidim. Generalizing, it's already a big mistake. Because sometimes you can have a fantastic jewel and you miss it because of stupid opinions. You have to check. But before you go on a date, you have to know what's the limitation. You understand the limitation? If this girl, she declare herself as Chabadnikit, you have to be Chabadnik. She's not going to take you if you're not. So why wasting your time? Yes and no. Yes and no. Hashem wants Jews to marry Jews and to live according to His Torah. Right? If Hashem says in the Torah that you have the restriction is not to shave with a razor, meaning Hashem doesn't mind that a person will have a short beard. Right? But the way the world developed, according to some people, is the most important thing in their life. Like one Hasid once told me, by us, I would rather my son would be Mechalel Shabbat than change his Hasidish clothes. Told me in front of the audience. One rabbi, not a little... That's what he said. So some people think like that. So the idea is like this. People connect with people that comes from the same ideology and the same style. American with American. Israelis with Israeli. Of course, there's an exception to the rule. There's Americans with Israeli also. There's European with Americans. There's all kinds, right? But It's easier when you come from the same background, Litvish with Litvish, Hasidish with Hasidish. It doesn't mean that there's no possibility to do it with someone that is not your kind. If you put an X on it, just because he's not one of your group, then it's not what Hashem wants. Because maybe that's the shiduch. Do you think Hashem cares Litvish or Hasidish? He cares Shomer Shabbat, Baal Midot, Modesty. That's what Hashem cares about. All the customs are secondary. And not the most important thing, like some people think, if the hat will be like this or like that. Or the socks will be white or black. It became the Ten Commandments. That's not what Hashem cares so much. It's tradition, and people respect the way of their father, and we have to respect it as well. But it's not the Ten Commandments. There are things that are life and death. First, you check them. You don't check things that are not so critical. You understand? The accent, not so important. This kind of suit or the other one, it's not so important. It's much more important if the person is Yerei Shamayim, if he davens in Minyan, if he koveh itim LaTorah every day, if he's honest, if he's modest, if he's loyal, if he has good midot, he's Baal Chesed, he has emunah in Hashem, he's a lover of Hashem, he respects his parents, he respects Talmidei Chachamim. Then it's not so important if it's Litvish or Hasid or Sfaradi. It's not so important. It's that the things that I mentioned is a million times more important. But who am I to convince the whole world that they live in a lie? That's the most important thing for them. If you're one of us or not. The Gemara says, Hasida, it's a bird. It should have been kosher. Why? All the birds almost are kosher. There's a few birds that are not kosher, though, the murderers. The one that attack and murder, eagle, hawk. But all the other birds that are being attacked, they're all kosher, except the Hasida. The Hasida, the flamingo that stand on one leg. Why? Should have been kosher. Should have barbecued it and eat it. Why it's not kosher? The Gemara said the Hasida that makes chesed with its own kind. Hasida, the flamingos, they help each other, but they don't help other birds. You don't belong to our Hasidut. That's where the word Hasid comes from. So, because of that, Hashem say, Yutameh. But I'm doing chesed all day to my own kind. But not to other Jews. Meaning he's more important, he's a Jew and he's not a Jew for you. You're nothing for me. Yutameh. This is the message. What do you think the Gemara tells us about Hasidim? Hasidot.
But then, Rabbi, all the groups are Tameh. Faradim would never do favor to Ashkenazim.
Where are you living from? What are you talking about? What? Well, it's nonsense what you say. Faradim helps Ashkenazim, and Ashkenazim helps Faradim, and there's some differences that it's hard for them to communicate and to get married because of their ideology and accent and place of birth and customs. Yes, that makes a separation. But I'm telling you, there are tens of thousands of couples that are mixed, Sfaradim and Ashkenazim, and they're working very well.
Every time you go to Sfaradim, they're going to make jokes, understand, in a funny way.
Jokes everyone makes.
Yeah, I don't know why this Ashkenazim making the half shaking okay. Like this.
You saw Donald Trump and Hillary, you know how much they hate each other? Not like we love each other, we're just not different. They hate each other and they still shook hands. You understand?
I didn't know the saying that doesn't people don't know how the tree grows up and that's why they're shaking the other way. I didn't know that's a kind of law. Now I know.
No, when I was making a joke, I say even those two enemies that want to kill each other, they ended up shaking hands. We, Baruch Hashem, don't hate each other. We love each other. We just have differences. And it's harder to communicate. It's hard for Moroccan to live with a woman that will cook gefilte fish for him. It's very difficult. But you know how many thousands of Moroccans ended up marrying Ashkenazi and eat gefilte fish and lick their fingers? I've seen in my eyes. It's possible.
You can try to convince me as much as you want. Go to Chabad. When they accept you,
they don't accept me. They don't accept me for different reason. Meaning, my ideology and the way I give lectures is totally different than their. It's totally different than their style. But I promise you one thing: when I will drive on the highway and see a Chabadnik with a flat tire, I will be the first one to stop for him, and I'm sure it will be the other way around when he see me stuck. Maybe he won't marry my daughter, that's a different story. Or my son, because he wants long beard. That's a different reason. But as far as doing for each other, I promise you that when the time comes, everyone will help everyone. Thank you very much. Shavua Tov. Israel.